Thank you, Luisa, for the presentation. I thank you all. I thank mainly to the organization for being here, and it's a pleasure. And I thank you all for your presentations. I've learned a lot all the days. I'm going to present a perhaps very controversial issue, the difficult relations between images, mainly visual images, and body. From a special perspective, from a perspective, the perspective of an environmental science, not only from a semiotic point of view, although semiotics can help us to understand better the power of images. And I will go to present you some preliminary considerations about these methods, or perhaps this environmental perspective. The first consideration, environments and communication. First of all, our science, the science of media and mediation, should consider the hypothesis to deal with environments and not only with products, or signs, or texts, or discourse. An environment doesn't need products at all. It needs participants with an historical background and with future projections, desires, potentialities. And this is an important difference. A product without any calculation about future projections and risk can become an environmental violence, while a participant is the result of a development process and a social historical contract with our history and with our future. Thus, I do not intend to speak about image as products, a simple object. I intend to speak against the production of product images. Instead of this, it would be more instigating to understand an image as a complex of object, subject, and project, as a living and complex participant of our human, social, and mental environment, sometimes including the qualities of a projectile, as Pepita Hesselbart has showed yesterday. Its possibility to cause environmental revolutions, small or huge changes, sometimes even extremely harmful. This is the main focus of my presentation: explosion and destruction of human bonds between mankind and others, including nature, between me and the other, between me and my body. Explosion or devaluation of affects, explosion and even destruction of life itself in its most subtle forms, as for instance, inner life, creative life, or inner psychic images. Destructive interference in the generation and healthy preservation of body images. This all can be caused by the increasing and omnipresent distribution of image products without any preoccupation with environmental question in the broad sense too, even in the sense of mental, psychic environment or educational environment. On the other side, images are essential participants of human life. They are part of us and partner with us. Since we are beings with an eccentric positionality, this is a concept by Helmut Plessner, eccentrische Positionalität, that we are a body and we have a body. From the external point of view, from the internal point of view, we are a body. and we are both. Thus, images are very important for us as two to decipher and understand the others and ourselves. They are indispensable as tools to help us in the construction and in the maintenance of our bonds with the world, with our neighborhood, and with ourselves, including our body. Dietmar Kampe, a very important philosopher in the field of sociology of the body, told me one day, in German, then the translation, sei nicht so böse zu den Bildern. Sie können uns die Schmerzen lindern. With rhyme. Do not be so angry about images. They can mitigate our pains. Preliminary consideration two. What is an image? From the perspective of the phylogenesis, every social animal has to deal with images in order to survive in the struggle for life. All senses are important to capture images from the outer world and decipher them properly. Therefore, all perceptible stimuli are received as images. This is a new concept of image, not only visual, through the eyes or through the ears, through the nose or through the tongue and through the skin. Visual images are very important for all primates and birds, but perhaps not the most important for wolves and dogs. Acoustic images, indispensable for pre-humans in the savannah, became verbal language. Ants and bees, as well, most insects, have a very special capacity for the smell images. A so-called chemical communication through smells and pheromones. The communication via taste and tongue and lips exists too and has a special importance for all mammals. It's therefore possible to say about the generation of taste images from the earliest childhood to the old ages. There is an exchange of taste images when you kiss someone or when you eat something. Consideration three, distance communication, nearness communication, and intimateness communication. Throughout the ontogenesis, the use of images migrates from environments of intimateness and nearness to distance environments. But the role of multisensorial images generated by the skin contact, by the smell, and by the taste senses has an immense power for the development of healthy human beings. Several investigations about the role of the skin contact, from the classic one by Harry Harlow and his experiments with infant rhesus monkeys, to the impressive, astonishing investigations by Ashley Montague on the human significance of the skin, and those more contemporary by Boris Cyrulnik on the development of all the senses in small children and before the birth, including. All of them show the evidence of intimacy images as the birth of human beings, but not only human, and the birth of human communication. The following development of communication emerges in the proximity environment using the senses of touch and smell. Therefore, touch images and smell images, but as well the senses of sight and hearing in an expanded social space. The social distance environment is developed as a consequence of the expansion of individual space in social communication, communities. Sight is the predominant sense, the sense of distance par excellence, as the main form of alertness associated with fear. Thus, visual images in their deepest origins have somehow a phobic, fearful nature. Here lies perhaps the strongest power of visual images. Hence, this is the main thesis of Abi Warburg when he defines a visual image as pathos formula of pathos, emotion or passion. Consideration four. I have a huge list of numbers. We'll be tired. Hegemony of visual images. The deepest roots of hegemony of visual images lie in the beginnings of civilization, understood as the moment when humans built settlements and began to belong things, to accumulate things. The development of writing, born with the accounting function, was an important step for the universalization of a secondary medium, which depends on the sense of sight, because signs were recorded in the clay, on stones and wood, and so on. Let's jump some thousand years. Two events fostered the dominance of visual images: the development of the printing press by Johannes Gutenberg, 1440, and the explosion of the exhibition value diagnosed by Walter Benjamin, with roots in the visual revolution of the Renaissance, which was potentialized by the infinite range of possibilities of technical and mechanical reproduction from the 17th century to the 20th. Visual images became more and more present in mundane spaces, not only in churches or temples. Jochen Hörisch classified as the first mass media and the first mass images of the world the coins and the images of the Last Supper. Technical devices invented in the last two centuries brought us the incredible possibility to produce and distribute images by ourselves on a large scale. Mobile images devices are able to ease the universal access to images wherever you are. And visual images became omnipresent as substitution of natural landscapes in the cities, in our houses, in our pockets, over the skin, as clothes, and in the skin, as tattoos. The following question should be placed: what kind of impact does this visual saturated environment have on our body, on our time and space, perception, on our relationships, on our children, on our educational environment, and on our labor relationships? What about the other senses, proximity and intimacy, and their balance? Consideration number five, and last consideration. the flood of visual images. The flood of visual media is a global phenomenon. As showed Nicholas Mirzoev with astonishing numbers. Their large and rapid expansion through magazines, posters, leaflets, advertising, photographs, screens, murals, television, the internet, mobile devices, etc., changed the face of the world. Some aspects of this change are: first, it's an expression by Flusser, by Wilhelm Flusser, the hurricane of media delivers images through the universal electrification of Earth, early diagnosed by Abi Warburg in 1895. First in the towns, and inside the houses, and recently inside our pockets. Our pockets are electrical. The second aspect, all image devices reproduce ad nauseam and very quickly exogenous. This is an expression by Hans Belting, or external images. It's a question. Can they disturb or even block the flow of the processing and the creative production of endogenous internal psychic images? I repeat, can the flood of images, of external images, block the flow of our internal images, our creative internal images? Third aspect, according to Dietmar Kamper, I quote, against the existing original image, singular, the unique original image of the fear of death, there is only one option, and this option is to produce images in the plural. End of quotation. This is the anthropological root of every kind of reproduction or repetition in rituals, in psychic disorders, in social crises, but also in all-day life, and mainly today, nowadays, in the media. The contemporary forms of visual friendships are also founded on an endless repetition of the same that conducts to a kind of emptiness. Therefore, the age of mechanical reproduction reaches its climax and turns into a kind of era of iconophagy, of devouring images. Well, the preliminary consideration are ready, and now we have the second part, types of iconophagy. A typology of the iconic appropriation of the other. This is the definition of iconophagy, the iconic appropriation of the other. And I will show you six types of iconophagy. First of all, material iconophagy. This is the case when image supports or image material are eaten as part of certain religions, rituals, play, celebrations. For instance, in the Sunday of the Dead in Mexico, when sweets sweet skulls are eaten. Or holy bread for certain holidays. Los caramelos de la Virgen in Spain. Or the paper pills in São Paulo, in my city. There are paper pills from Saint Galvão, as pílulas de São Galvão, and when you have a problem, we go to the church and we can buy such pills and eat them. It's paper. It's image. It's an image. But it is material too. Swallowing stamps are produced in Passau, Germany, since the 18th century. We can swallow them too. They are swallowing stamps with images of saints. In certain exceptional political conditions, in dictatorships, for instance, pictures must be eaten, either within a torture action or before the torture action in order to destroy an evidence or a proof. I had several friends that had to eat Karl Marx, the whole capital. You can imagine. It's a huge problem for the stomach. The second kind of iconophagy is the immaterial iconophagy. The immaterial image is eaten in order to incorporate qualities of the image. In the presence of the image, I think the so-called prana eaters. Did you hear this? Prana eaters. People that eat prana, energy, cosmic energy. Or light eaters. It's very actual and modern in order to be not so fat. Light eaters. This kind of swallowing process must not happen through the mouth. It can also happen by breathing a certain immaterial quality or via touch. In Padua, for instance, in Italy, everybody wants to touch the stone where Saint Anton is there. By a touch and skin, I think the phenomenon of possession by ghosts or spirits can be seen as a kind of immaterial iconophagy, too. The third topic is the natural iconophagy. This is the most natural process. Images feed on other images. This creates reoccurring motifs in the history of images. For example, sacred images in religion are a heritage of motifs of pagan cultures. This is also shown by Abi Warburg. Art images have a large tradition of holy and mythological images. Behind them, as inspiration or as model, the power of an image emerges from the roots of its historical development in the mythical, in the religious, and in the artistic environment. Not only art history is a result of this endless devouring process, but also contemporary media is fed by the copy-paste procedure. rescuing images from the whole history of images. The conscious or unconscious citation, quotation, copy of certain images or image parts belongs as well to this type of iconophagy, thanks to which a history of image would generally be clearly perceptible. A very clear example would be the appropriation and destruction and reconstruction or eating process of Las Meninas of Velázquez by Picasso, by Buñuel, by Valdés, and many other artists, filmmakers, and advertisers, and philosophers. The fourth type of iconophagy is the civilizational iconophagy. This refers to the acquisition of civilizational images, like behavioral images, aesthetic patterns. This occurs by the coexistence of family, communities, social groups, companies, education and training, through institutions, also religions, football, nations, and so on, no? That convey the value system of a culture. And finally, the appropriation of images through the use of media. This is a process of social adaptation and social integration through the development of a common repertoire. And then, 5.5, the post-civilizational iconophagy. This refer to the compulsive appropriation of images and the irresistible consumption of images by excessive, repeated, and ubiquitous supply so that one becomes gradually identified with them. This is also inspired by Gunther Anders, and he called this iconomania, iconomanie. Life can be a picture of life. The house is a house of pictures. And so with the clothes and the food, in order to be in the Facebook. All of them must have a high percentage of visibility and must be able to be photographed and distributed. Compulsive consumption of brands belongs to this category. TV addiction, games addiction, computer addiction, screen addiction, and uncountable other forms of image addictions are nowadays a new issue for the investigation and preoccupation of physicians, psychiatrists, psychologists, as well as parents. This is already a transition to a new radical form of iconophagy, and the last one, number 6, last and very complicated hard form of iconophagy. This is the retrospective or retroactive iconophagy. This is about the opposite situation. Images are consumed in extremely high frequency, so that we can say that the bodies are consumed by images and by the imaginary. Here we have several forms that could be classified as retroactive iconophagy. Some of them are not related to the mediatic environment immediately. But other forms of environment, as religion, for instance, faith, fanatism, or sometimes for political reasons. Now I have a very large list of forms of retroactive iconophagy. 12 at all. Mm-hmm. Prepare yourself. Mm-hmm. First of all, voluntary renunciation of the body. That would be the first form of retroactive iconophagy, the voluntary destruction of the body in favor of an ideology, a policy, or a religion. It means in favor of an image life. Kamikaze pilots, explosive bodies, are example of replacement of life by an image life. Second, the loss of proprioception. Proprioception is the self-perception of the body. Here we can have even heart pathological disturbances in the body image. And this is a medical expression. Nowadays, physicians have to deal with body image disturbances. It's a kind of disease. Such as body, disturbances in the body image, such as anorexia, bulimia, and the like. As a neurological disease, it was the subject of two chapters of the book The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat by the neurologist, British-American neurologist Oliver Sacks. Perception or self-perception is responsible for the production of the endogenous image of one's own body. It's the so-called sixth sense, in addition to the five already known senses, smell, sight, touch, hearing, and taste. It was discovered by Charles Sherrington in the last decade of the 19th century, most than 100 years ago. As a culture-related cognitive disorder or a cultural disease, the loss of proprioception occurs probably as an increasingly frequent phenomenon which leads to social as well as physical psychosomatic pathologies. Because the loss of this sense, somehow replaced by that of the sight, the excess of media can interfere in the perception of the body. Third point, screen addiction. In this area of pathologic relations between images and people appear the pathological symptoms of the screen addiction, which is life-threatening, with life-threatening consequences, as, for instance, loss of sociability, loss of reality perception, loss of social time and synchronization of time. In extreme cases, loss of self-awareness and loss of self-perception, and even death. Fourth point, the body is a raw material for the production of images. The body is considered only as a raw material, a base, a pretext for image production and use. The body must therefore be able to become an image. The body has to be exemplary, pictorial, photogenic, healthy, forever young, etc. That is, it must already be an image body. From the outset, which must be capable of producing images. It is the opposite of the hierarchical values of human existence, or its natural order. The images are not intermediaries, instruments or tools, but they are an end in itself, a goal, a target. And the bodies are only means. This also leads to the spread of the phenomenon of increasing self-referentiality of the imagery. Self-referentiality. This means that an image no longer shows things, but only other images. The media has been reporting less the world than the media. This phenomenon has been diagnosed by Flusser when he claimed that the pictures have no longer a window function to the world, but they became a screen in front of the world which shows only itself as a screen. Also, according to Dietmar Kamper, this process was called the orbit of the imaginary. And I quote, the imaginary, this is a very, very special concept of imaginary, different from the other concepts of imaginary, very specific. The imaginary is the general word for the dead dreams of mankind, for the spare artifacts of the power of imagination, for the remains of all this, what you had in mind, what has been produced, what has been shown, for the disappointment of a utopic high voltage policy, for rundown elements of techno imagination, for the empty forms of philosophy and arts, in a simple word, for the rubble of human history, which is by no means disappeared, but that is installed around the globe as an impenetrable barrier. From a certain point of the installation of this artificial world, there is no more the outside and nor the other. End of quotation of Dietmar Kamper. Point five, the production of the gaze. Here we are concerned with the acquisition of life and the habitat of people by the image production and for the images. Because the images are nothing without our eyes, the eyes of the viewers, the growing image production needs a growing number of spectators. Therefore, viewers must be built by the visual media. And of course, this happens only through sedation. As sedation strategies are used, eye catchers first, then repetition and ritualization, and then a calming and anesthetic repertoire with already known images. And last but not least, the sitting position. Number six, the crisis of visibility. According to Dietmar Kamper, the consequence of the flood of images is the reduction of its impact And at the same time, the emergence and growth of a crisis of visibility. We can see always less and less and less. And therefore, the image must be reproduced more and more and more. Point seven, last. Blinding in multiplication. Because of the tired, blinded eyes by exhaustion, images will be replicated with increased and repeated production. The strategy of endless repetition can produce two kinds of reaction. The first one is to overcome the resistance of the eyes. The second one produces more numbing blindness. Point number eight, Star War strategy. The conquest of the eyes and of the mental images is a Star War with refined strategies. The viewers are scanned in their capacity of seeing and classified according to the micro gestures of the eyes reaction. Therefore, we are all scanned in our views, in our eyes. Point nine, we are observed by the images. Always, when an image is produced in order to impact our eyes, it is produced because it has already observed ourselves. It's a consequence of the Star War. It knows about us much more than we know about it. The world of media images with ads, television, etc., has long seen us before we get to see it. It knows how we are, how we live, what we like or hate, what we read or not read, what we see, and through big data, what will happen in our future. Point 10, the colonization of imagination. The production of endogenous inner images is pushed back by the pressure and the invasion of external images. So that one thinks, following the rules of those external images. Quick, superficial, bodiless, abstract, without flesh and skin, without time, without emotion. 11, point 11, appropriation and expropriation. The epic end of the life of photographer Bill Biggert, dead under the rubble of the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center on September 11th, 2001, shows an impressive transformation of the body into image. He couldn't help the temptation to enter the picture. His digital photos were rescued and give testimony to his suicide in the world of spectacular images. Now let's find the last point. It will be interesting if it's lost. it can be devoured. Here it is. It was almost devoured. Bubigat's charred cameras were shown to the world via internet. He rushed to the site of catastrophe in the seconds preceding the second attack in order to enter into an imagetical life and therefore expropriating the time of his own body. This was still point 11. Now 12, the pre-dreamed dreams. This is a beautiful image, to dream a pre-dreamed dream. I'm going to illustrate this kind of images using the final scene of a Brazilian movie, Macunaíma, the hero without a character. This movie is based on, the film is made in the year 1969 by Joaquim Pedro de Andrade, and is based on the novel of the 20s by Mário de Andrade, an important art piece of the Brazilian art movement Anthropophagy, 1928. This is the last scene. The hero, finally back in the Amazonas jungle, his body and his teeth and his clothes in decay, after having had spectacular adventures in the big cities, he goes back to the Amazon. But still eager of play. Play is the word brincar in Portuguese. It is make love. He was very strong in decay. But he doesn't see that this woman in a very beautiful young woman, object of his dreams, swimming in a small idyllic lake, and he doesn't see that this woman is the mythical Yara, or Uyara, a very known devourer. And he dives into the water immediately and is also immediately devoured. At the end, only his green jacket floating in the blood-stained water is left. Let's see the scene.
Now, Carol. Que é bom beber à vontade. E essa moça lindíssima não era moça, não. Era o Yara.
comedora de gente. Como ela só se mostrava de frente e afastava sem virar, Macunaíma não viu o buraco no cangote por onde a pérfida respirava.
Dreams are sometimes inoculated in our horizons so that we can be forced to dream them. Thank you very much.